comments as well from the Ministry of Interior and Coordination of National Government as well, agreeing with me on these particular matters. For a long time, we have always been on the forefront. And Chairman, you will agree with me. I have always presented issues to you regarding issues to do with the police. And in the police force, we do have those who are very, very good people. People who are patriotic, people who have put their lives at risk, people who, when they go out there, if anything happens to them, then the livelihood of those who are behind them is affected as well. So what this bill is seeking to do is to try and compensate that in the event someone gets hurt while on duty, then it is only fair that that person is recognized and compensated. If someone dies in the course of duty, then it is only fair and right that that person's family is going to equally be compensated. I have looked at the concerns that have been raised by the National Police Service Commission, where they indicate that the Workers Injuries Benefit Act of 2007 already includes these matters. But Chair, let us be honest and realistic. For the sake of the thousands who put their lives out at stake for this country, I think it is better for us, and I would expect that the National Police Service Commission to actually say that instead of this bill not going through, then why don't we include a clause in the Workers' Insurance Benefit Act to remove, because it does include that this does not apply to those in the armed forces. Why don't we say that those who are employed by the National Police Service as well are removed in that act? And I'll tell you why. Because you go through the records, and I'm hoping that those who are in parliamentary research can do that. Go through the records. How many people from the year 2007 that this was enacted into law have been able to get their rightful dues? Because this process involves going to the Treasury, Chair. Now, can you imagine a police officer based somewhere in Lodwar, and then that police officer, wherever he is, he goes somewhere where the terrorists or there's bad elements and something happens to him. And you're asking him to go and raise back his money through Treasury, the trauma that that person goes to. I represent an urban constituency, Mvita constituency, and I had an incident in our own constituency where there's a police officer who was shot outside a bank. That police officer till today has never been compensated. And if the National Police Service Commission is going to say that, you know what, once you get hurt, once you are no longer of value or use, then you're no longer our responsibility, move on. In today's day and age, even the normal practice that is there for anyone who employs, and I would expect that the commission, being a commission in itself and an entity on its own, and not an amorphous body of government, should actually embrace this. I can understand, as the national, the ministry has said, that they have a bit of concerns in terms of wording so that this does not get misused. That is something that can be comprehended and can be accepted. But I urge the commissioners to actually accept this. And I'm sure you have a lot of claims on your own doorsteps where people actually go, and it would have been very nice as well, other than the report, to even receive from yourself that from the year 2007, when the WIBA was put into effect till today, how many officers have actually been compensated through that? How many people, if someone dies, and dies for this country, and dies for the safety of other Kenyans, and that person has put their lives at risk, you know, how many of them are actually being compensated?
Well stated. Thank you very much, Mheshimiwa Nasir, and thank you for the interest you've shown. You are, we have always compared notes on police matters, and I think I love the enthusiasm and the interest that you have in seeing to it that officers who lose their lives in the line of duty or those who get injured are really compensated, you know, appropriately.
I had been engaged in personally authorizing payments for police officers who had been injured in the course of their work. And it was very often very depressing, the kind of experience I had with the police officers who, if you looked at them and if you considered what it is they were being paid and after how long, especially when you are trying to seek funds from the treasury, it made it necessary that even at that time there be need to consider the plight of a police officer who not only is a public servant, but a public servant of a very specialized kind, the man or woman that protects us round the clock.
This is a positive development in trying to see that police officers are suitably, but more importantly, expeditiously compensated. In terms of the intention of the law, we believe that this is a move that is called for, and we also sympathize and empathize with police officers whom we deal with on a daily basis on the trials and tribulations which they go for.
The thought by Honorable Nasir, or the intention, is very good. I think it is very good intention, and the objective, I believe, is to have the police officers injured in the course of their duty compensated. In case of death, their families are also compensated.
Initially, I thought the National Police Service Commission was totally against the bill. That was my impression. But the verbal presentation looks like they accept the amendment.
It is us to speak on behalf of those who are voiceless. But from the input of the commission, I am of the assumption that they will come up with some form of amendments to these bills, and we will sit down with your legal department as well, draft these particular amendments. We can even include this to be a whole part into the existing National Police Service Act to give detailed explanation of what an injury is and things like that. And when we were drafting this, Chair, I think it is important for the members to note, when we were drafting this particular bill, when we sat down with the legal department, the reason why we did not put these nitty-gritties inside, that what constitutes as an injury, it was because it was deemed from a legal perspective that that should be something left to the judicial part. That is what they had given that advice. But if we want to put it into details where it is, even if it's as comprehensive as 200 pages, to say what constitutes a toe, defining what a finger is, defining everything else, it is perfectly okay with me. The end of the day, I think what is most important is that we try and assist those who are voiceless. Thank you, Chair.
Do a presentation.